There we go. We live now. Oh, yeah. That's a beautiful thing. Come on in the house. Come on in the house. I don't know where you are in the United States, but this morning we had some beautiful music from heaven. Boy, those thunderstorms were real. And I'm going to tell you right now, they make me sleep like a baby because I know God is here and near when I hear him working. So y'all come on in the building. Good morning, everybody. I see y'all coming in. We coming in here to worship and proclaim the name of Jesus this morning. It's a beautiful day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. As Pastor and I were praying this morning before we were getting started, and he referenced the fact that, you know, this is Palm Sunday. And I'm going to be honest with you, immediately my heart kind of did a little tilt because I can recall and reflect on it when we were in traditional church, and we would have our palms and we would be waving them back and forth. But as he was praying, it did not take away the meaning of what this Sunday means. Because when you think about it, Jesus for us on Palm Sunday was that example of what courage is. Courage is not being unafraid. Courage is not not having fear. You know, a lot of people will shun or walk to the left side of letting someone know I was afraid. It's okay to be afraid. Courage is moving forward in spite of that fear, because the Spirit of God overrides the spirit of fear every day. And as we come together to receive a word from God, this word gives us courage to walk in the face of fear. Whether you are afraid of your finances drying up, whether you are afraid of contracting COVID, whether you are afraid of your house being foreclosed on, whether you are afraid of your marriage dissolving in front of your eyes, God, when you have God's word and you are standing and walking in the power of God, you can face those fears and you can walk forward in courage. And that's why we come together. That's why we come together to receive God's word, so we can be encouraged and empowered to move forward in spite of our fears and do his will. I'm going to stop because I'm starting to preach, I think, but you know, I'm glad to be here. I'm excited to be here. So y'all, let's go ahead and move forward in the service. How about let's bow our heads for a moment of invocation. Heavenly Father, we are grateful and we are thankful that you have allowed us to see another day. God, we are excited about the courage and the strength that your word is going to bring. God, we cannot do anything without you, so we do not dare move one step forward without acknowledging that you are in the building. God, we know that we are still yet worshiping in a virtual format, but our worship is anything but virtual. Our worship is real. And God, as we come before you, we want to exemplify what you asked for when you called those to worship you in spirit and in truth. So the only way we can do that is if you let your Holy Spirit that abides with us rest on us right now. Envelop us, engulf us with your spirit this morning, God, so that everything that comes forth from our hearts and out of our mouth and through our hands and in the dance and in the song and out of the preaching can show forth your glory, your wonderful works, and bottom line, so somebody can be saved. God, I ask you right now in the name of Jesus, bring somebody to this Facebook Live broadcast this morning that does not know you. Bring by a stranger. They may come by wanting one thing, but God, I want you to let them leave with another. God, let them know that the silver and gold is not what they need, but what they need is a relationship and a partnership and a sweet fellowship with you. Holy Spirit, have your way in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Wow. So here we are. We're Palm Sunday. It is also the last Sunday in March. So therefore, this is the last time we will be singing the hymn of the month together. But y'all write down the title to this hymn. Y'all keep this hymn close to your hearts, because even though we may not sing it together again for a long time, this is one of those things and one of those hymns you can recall at every turn and every journey in your life. When darkness veils his lovely face, you can rest on the fact that the morning will break and the dawn will come anew, and there will be glory after this. And that morning will be just as bright and shiny as the first morning he ever created, when he said, "Let there be light," and he said it was good. So let us join our voices, our hearts, our souls, our spirits together as we sing this beautiful hymn of the church, "Morning Has Broken." And yeah, Valerie, I see it's thundering where you are, but the morning is still breaking, baby. Love you.
Morning has broken.
That last verse right there, and that last image that he always has portrayed on the screen on that last verse. I mean, when you think about it, every morning is a piece of that first morning in the Garden of Eden. this morning is just an image and a reflection of the original morning when God said, let there be light. Speak life and light into your darkness and praise Him. Even though it may still be cloudy, even though the thunder is still rolling in your life, even though the lightning flashes catch you off guard, praise Him with elation that there will be a new morning and a dawning of a new day. Y'all keep that one. Keep it, and sing it. That's one of them songs. Perfect it. Oh, wow. Okay, so let's move forward because we got a word today coming. I know we do. So open your Bibles to Mark chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. Mark chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. And I will wait a moment because I really want you to go there. I know we're going to have the words up on the screen for you, but I want you to get used to, I put it this way. Sometimes we get so used to technology that we forget the beauty and the blessedness of what it means to be able to live in a world where you can hold a Bible in your hand and not be afraid of being arrested and being accosted and being persecuted. You know, people may say all they want to about the United States of America, but I am free to worship God as I want, when I want, how I want. And sometimes I just like holding that Bible in my hand because I can, and to turn the pages with those ancient words on it. So I want you to read along with us. But we do thank God for technology, provide these words for you on the screen so that we can read this together. Mark chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. Read along with me as I read these words aloud. So when they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethpage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. And if anyone says to you, why are you doing this? Just say this: the Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately. So they went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. And as they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, what are you doing untying the colt? And they told them what Jesus had said. And they allowed them to take it. So then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. And many people spread their cloaks on the ground, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. And then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven. And this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Hosanna. All right, it is prayer time. And I want us to get close to the fire this morning. And I really, really desire to pray with you and for you. I have been elated to see how God has been answering our prayers. Not if God, but how God is answering our prayers. And one of the things that I celebrate is how God is answering the prayers in the family. People have been praying for their loved ones to draw near to God and for their loved ones to have a closer walk with God, and for their loved ones to trust God, and to believe in God, and yes, for their loved ones to be saved, and just to see God's hand on the family, protecting the family. God honors the relationship, the marriage, the relationship between mother and daughter and father and son. He asks us to honor those relationships. He asks us to honor our parents. He asks us not to provoke our children. He wants us to honor the family. And when we pray for healing in our families, not just physical healing, but when we are bold enough to say, God, we need you to intervene. We need an intervention from God. God says, psh, you ain't said nothing but a word. And God comes in and he does what he does so sweetly and so with a two-edged sword, cha-cha. And he cuts away the fat of indifference and hatred and callous hearts. And he cuts away all of that that doesn't matter. And he leaves us looking in the face of one another with love, realizing maybe for the first time in a long time, you know what? We got to focus on what really matters. And it ain't that stuff we were fussing about and arguing about. Because life is precious and life is short. Life is just a vapor. Poof, we will be gone before you know it. And if we have spent our lives hanging on to stuff that does not matter, it will not end well. So allow God this morning to do a circumcision on your heart, to cut away that extra stuff off of your heart that does not matter, and to create in you a clean heart so that we can not only forgive our enemies, but we can love them too, and we can embrace them, that we can pray for them. And God is going to do a great thing. I know he is. Thanking God also this morning for a little Faith. We prayed for her last week, Cassandra Roberts' grandbaby. Was born not even 3 ounces, but let me tell you, Faith is walking in faith, and Faith is here pressing and growing and meeting her milestones. And we are just grateful to each and every one of you who called her little name out loud. Continue to pray for her and her father Brandon and her mom Ashley and her little sister, or her big sister Leia, that in God's time, that Faith will be coming home and be growing up in the admonition of the Christ that her family loves. Y'all keep filling these comment sections up with your prayer requests, and be reminded that we go back through this entire service, sometimes twice, just to make sure we did not miss any prayer requests. And we pray over these prayers. We pray with you. And then we bring them to our Wednesday morning prayer call, and we pray again. And then every now and then we reach out just to find out how God is answering, so that we can be encouraged and so that we can encourage one another. And y'all continue to do that. Encourage one another and let each other know that you're praying with and for somebody. And now, as we have these prayers on our lips and in our hearts, let's take them to the throne of grace. Amen. Amen. Heavenly Father, God Almighty, precious Savior, Alpha and Omega, Rose of Sharon, my everlasting Father, my Prince of Peace, the place I can always go to be safe. I call on that name, that blessed name right now, humbly but excited to know that you are Emmanuel, you are God with us. God, we, few of your children, have gathered here today just to say thank you. Yeah, God, just to say. First, just saying thank you, Lord, for all that you have done for us. A songwriter says that tragedies are commonplace in all kinds of diseases. People are slipping away. The economy's down. People can't get enough pay. And in some cases, that's the very people under the sound of my voice. But still, God, in spite of all of these things, all we can say is thank you, Lord, for all you've done for us. God, thank you for the blessed assurance that as long as we have you, we have everything we need. God, we're coming to you right now, and we are grateful to know that we are calling on a name that is above every name. God, sometimes the names that come up around us would cause us to tremble in fear. The names like COVID and cancer and bankruptcy and foreclosure and unemployment and sickness. God, but we know that the name of Jesus, when we call on that great name, everything else gets small. God, when we magnify you above everything else, no other name matters but the name of Jesus. And right now, God, we call on the great name of Jesus and say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for being a protection in the midnight hour. Thank you, Lord, for keeping us safe in our travels. Thank you, Lord, for being with us in the hospital. And thank you, Lord, for bringing us home. God, thank you, Lord, for protecting us from those things seen and those things we cannot see. Thank you, Lord, because only you could be a shield to protect us from all of these things. God, you have even had to protect us from our own dumb stuff sometimes, and we just want to say thank you. God, thank you for your mercy, for not giving us what we deserve. Thank you for your grace that strengthens us to go on and do the next right thing. Thank you, God, for your love that undergirds us sometimes when we can be so unlovable. Thank you, God, for your forgiveness that enables us to forgive those who have wronged us. Thank you, God, for your embrace in the midnight hour when we feel so all alone. Thank you, God, for the hope that comes in serving you and knowing that there will be a new morning and a brighter day and the sun will shine again. Thank you, God, for bringing us through a whole year of being under restrictions and prohibitions and social distancing and not being able to reach out and touch one another. But God, thank you for your touch that has sustained us and that has strengthened our love for you and our love for one another even more. Thank you for a greater love. Thank you for a greater song. Thank you, God, for a greater peace. Thank you, God, for vision. Thank you, God, for provision. Thank you, God, for your keeping. And thank you for hearing and answering our prayers. God, as we bring these petitions to you, we lay them at your feet. We aren't giving you any instructions. God, we're not going to tell you what to do. Because we don't know. We don't know how this goes. Only you know the beginning and the end. So we're just going to lay them before you. God, there they are, finances. Do what you want. We're not going to tell you what to do. We're not going to tell you increase them. We're not going to tell you find them. We're not going to tell you fold them. There you are, God, finances. God, marriage, there you are. Have your way. God, children, they're yours. On your altar, there they are. Do what you need to do. Thy will be done. God, physical pain, disease, diagnoses, there they are, God, all of it. There's the diagnosis, there's the pain, there's the discomfort, my body, there, right there, you do it. I can't fix it. I didn't create me. God, mental anguish and stress and anxiety. Oh, God, here you go. I don't even know where to begin. Here you go. It's yours. We give it to you. We lay it at your feet. God, take all of these things. Take them all. Line them up with your plan and your purpose for us. And then give us a heart and a mind to embrace, accept, and walk in your will. Yes, Lord, thy will be done. And there's nothing else to say but amen. 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 Y'all, we got the easy part. We don't have to come up with a plan. We don't have to figure it out. We just have to give it to him. And trust him. He has heard your prayers, and now we want to just give you a little song as we prepare for the word that will strengthen your hearts, and that we pray that will encourage and affirm you in your walk with Jesus Christ. Amen.
There is a name that's a place I can run. can call on that name and be saved. Things will change. Stand and proclaim. No greater name. Jesus stands, proclaim, no greater name, Jesus, don't you know that name heals all, and that name delivers all. It works. And that name heals all. And it delivers.
And as we call on the name of Jesus right now, we just asking you to fill our pastor with Holy Ghost power right now. God, you've called him to a great work. And by himself, he can't do this. But we know if we just call on the name of Jesus right now, that name, it will work. So we, as the family and friends of Amana, we join our hands and our hearts, and we lift him to you, God. Fill him, work through him, speak for him, anoint him afresh. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Hallelujah.
Good morning. It's good to be alive. Anybody grateful this morning? Anybody willing to stand and proclaim the goodness of Jesus? Well, there is a word from the Lord. And I want to look at Mark 11. Verses 8, 9, and 10. Mark 11, verses 8, 9, and 10. Says, many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven. Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for hymns of praise and scripture readings and virtual hugs and greetings that have been given, and for powerful songs of praise. But Lord, now we need to hear a word from you, a word that will hopefully stretch us. And those who already know you, Lord, a word that will help us to walk more like your Son, Jesus Christ. And for those who don't know you, Lord, we need a word that will lead someone to cry out, what must I do to be saved? So have your way, Lord, speak in this place. Your servants are listening. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight. Lord, you're my strength and my redeemer. Amen. Well, it's Palm Sunday. And what topic this morning, I just want to use the words ride on.
All right.
Ride on.
Ride on.
Now look, there's a spiritual that I learned way back. Ride on, King Jesus. No man can hinder me. Never really thought much about those words. In fact, all for years, I never even connected the hymn to Palm Sunday until later years. But Palm Sunday, this is the day all over the world where we celebrate what's known as the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. But do we really know why? Do we really have any better grasp on this day than those wild screaming masses on the first Palm Sunday? Because I remember growing up, we used to go to, there were several churches that I could go to as a child. And I remember at St. Luke United Methodist Church in Asheboro, they passed out actual palm branches, yeah. Right? That was fun. We'd be in the back playing with the palm branches. But over at Wesley Chapel, AME Zion Church in Asheboro, they passed out these little crosses. Anybody remember those? They take palm branches and cut them into a cross and give you little pins, and you can pin them to your lapel, right? And oh man, we would sit in the back and just have fun sticking one another with the pins, right? So we look forward to Palm Sunday, knowing I was going to get in trouble. Because Mom would be up in the pulpit and she'd be cutting that eye over there. And I knew I'm going to get it when I get home. But for me, Palm Sunday was either St. Luke and the palm branches or Wesley Chapel and the pin, right? And I, honestly, man, we didn't really think about what was going on. But it, look, if you ask me, I could give you the Sunday school answer. Oh yeah, we learned about it. I could tell you, this is the day we come to commemorate the day that Jesus rode triumphantly into the city of Jerusalem. I could give you the Sunday school answer. But did we really grasp the significance of Jesus riding in to Jerusalem on that day? And one thing I know, the people in Jerusalem didn't get it. Many of them were clueless, right? They were clueless. They were clueless about this man Jesus who was coming. Clueless. He had been walking his way toward Jerusalem all along, and people didn't get what was going on. They didn't understand his message. They had been 400 years with no prophet. And then John the Baptist comes up talking about repent, right? and prepare ye the way of the Lord. And something was happening, but the people couldn't put their finger on it. They knew something was different, but they were clueless. Then Jesus comes along. He gets baptized by John. A voice comes and says, "Behold my son in whom I am well pleased." And people begin to spread word that something was happening, but they were really, honestly, pretty clueless about what was going on. Mm-hmm. So Jesus began to teach, right? They didn't understand his teaching. They were clueless about his teaching. He said, "Love your enemies." What is that about? He said, "Blessed are you when people talk about you and persecute you falsely for my sake." And people were like, "What?" Clueless. They were clueless. He said, "Judge not, lest ye be judged." And people was, this dude, he's clueless. He told parables like the Good Samaritan and the prodigal son, and he did things that flipped the status quo. And he said things like, "The first shall be last, and the last shall be first." And folk were, honestly, there were folk following, but they were clueless.
I mean, come on, Jesus would he started performing all these miracles, right? He turned water into wine. They thought, oh, he's just a party animal. He healed a paralyzed man on the Sabbath day. And they said, oh, this man, he breaks the Sabbath laws. Folk reached out and touched his cloak, and and Jesus said, who touched me? And that folk were clueless. How are we supposed to know who touched you? They didn't get it. He just spoke and healed people from a distance. And people saw it and knew it, but they didn't quite grasp who this was. He spit on the ground and made mud and put it on somebody's eyes. And I can imagine us. Man, don't touch me with that mud. Clueless. Are you with me? He fed 5,000, right? And they wanted to make him a king, and Jesus had to slip away. People were clueless.
My.
He walked on the wind, spoke to the wind, and said, peace be still. And they said, what manner of man is this? They were clueless. And one day he asked his disciples, getting toward the end, you had to find out, have they learned anything? So he asked them, who do men say that I am?
There you go.
And they said, some say you're John the Baptist. Right. Some say you're Elijah. And others say you're Jeremiah or one of the prophets. Clueless. Peter finally answered and said, you are the Messiah. Jesus said, well, flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you. But don't tell nobody. You know why? Because folk are still clueless. They're clueless about what this Messiah thing. They're clueless. And then we get to this text, and things start to change. Right? It says in the text, when they were approaching Jerusalem, right, at Bethphage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, go into the village ahead of you, right? And immediately as you enter it, you're going to find a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. And if anybody asks you, what are you doing? Just say to them, the Lord needs it, and he'll send it back immediately. Something's going on. Jesus is setting things up for a bunch of clueless people. Jesus is setting things up. See, this is new. I talked about this last year. This is new. Jesus is making a definitive statement right here, because everywhere else he went, he walked.
Wow.
He went to Capernaum for the first time. He walked. When he went to teach the Sermon on the Mount, he walked.
He never rode nothing.
When the woman grabbed the hem of his garment, he wasn't riding anything. He was walking. He met 10 lepers outside of a city. He was walking. Mm-hmm. When he showed up at the house of Mary and Martha, and they were fussing about whether they should serve Jesus or serve food, he walked there. When he went to Jericho and people were flocking all around trying to see this guy from Nazareth, and blind Bartimaeus was yelling out, say, son of God, have mercy on me. And they told him to shut up. Guess what? Jesus was walking. He was walking, walking, walking. But this time, he says, look, go into the next village and get a donkey, because I'm about to ride this time. Most people today think of a donkey as nothing more than a humble beast of burden, but in that day, we flipped this thing about donkeys. Donkeys were seen as animals fit for a king to use. And so this time, Jesus, up until now, he didn't really want people to know who he was. But now, it's time for people to know who I am. I'm trying to erase the cluelessness, so I'm going to ride on. He wanted them to know, yes, I am the Messiah, the King of Kings, the Lion from the tribe of Judah. I know you folk know your scriptures. Jesus, the people knew their Old Testament scripture. He knew they knew Zechariah 9:9, where it said, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you triumphant and victorious is he, riding on an ass, a donkey, and upon the colt, the foal of an ass, a little young donkey." So he acted this thing out. He said, yes, you know the signs of the Messiah are he's going to come riding into Jerusalem on a donkey, and I'm going to do just that now because it's time. And so he did that thing. He was letting it be known there's a new king in the land, and this new king's methods would be different. So despite their cluelessness, he rode on. And so as he was riding in, people begin to throw their cloak, their coats and their cloaks and things on the ground. And others took palm branches and begin to wave them. And they were acknowledging that he was their king, but they still didn't quite get it. They were still a little clueless. They thought Jesus was coming in to wipe out the enemy. Nope. They thought he was going to come in and save them from Rome. That's why they cried out, Hosanna, which means save us now. But they were still clueless. But Jesus didn't come to wipe out the Romans. Jesus came to save the Romans. He didn't come to make everything all right. He came to make things harder. Jesus didn't come to Jerusalem to solve everybody's problems. He came to die, which was going to create some problems. And yet, because they were clueless, and because they were interested in self, they yelled, Hosanna, which means save us. They didn't understand. They were clueless of Christ, who he was. They were clueless of his, they didn't understand, but despite the cluelessness, Jesus rode on. Look here. Knowing he was a fugitive, knowing the folk in Jerusalem were setting out to kill him, he could have slipped in some side way, just kind of disguised himself and just kind of slipped in. But he said, no. I'm on a mission, and I want them to know. Who does that? Who comes in knowing folk are looking for you, plotting to take you out, and rides in and makes a big commotion and creates a big spectacle? Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Because he had a mission to make it to a cross, because he knew, like we said last week, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. So I have to face death. So he rode in, knowing this was his last week of life. He rode in, knowing Judas was going to betray him. He rode on, knowing his disciples would desert him. He rode on, knowing Peter was going to deny him three times. He rode on. He rode on anyway, knowing this would be grounds for execution. He rode on anyway, knowing they were going to beat him and mock him and spit on him and force thorns into his scalp and nails into his hands and his feet. He rode on anyway. Yes. Anybody today glad that he rode on? So despite the fact that they were clueless of who he was, they were clueless of his of why he was doing this, they just clueless, he still rode on. Let me tell you this, they were clueless of how significant this was. Right? Look. Anytime you have something major going on, there's always some folk who just miss the significance of the moment. Quick commercial example. Look, me and Selena got married in December of 1997.
You better remember.
Wonderful. Right. But in December of 1997, something significant happened. We were on our honeymoon in Charleston, South Carolina.
You know what?
December of 1997. We had just gotten to the hotel on our honeymoon, right? We just happened to flip on the TV, and I discovered that Patrick Ewing, the center for the New York Knicks, had blown out his knee and was done for the season, right? So I immediately knew the significance of this thing, right? I would tore up. This was a major event, great significance. Somebody better hear me now. But don't you know, whenever there's a major event, there's going to be other folk who don't quite see the significance.
You know what? You know what?
My wife is just skipping and hopping and jumping and ready to go eat. Let's go. We trust him. And I'm sitting on the side of the bed like, oh, my goodness, Patrick Ewing on a honeymoon. little joke. I love you, baby. Y'all see, though, people, significance of events, magnitude of events, everybody doesn't always get it. And these folk at this big parade on the first Palm Sunday, they didn't get it either, right? For some of them, it was just another parade.
Good analogy.
Right?
Good
analogy. Just another parade. Some of them just, you know, they had seen other false prophets come in, and this could be another one, but it's a parade, so let's go, right? But this was the Son of God coming into Jerusalem to give his life as a ransom for the sins of not only you, but the sins of the whole world. This was huge. This was significant. This was the king who would establish the line of David on the throne forever, just like it had been prophesied, and folk were clueless. This was the one Isaiah was talking about when he said, surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. We accounted him stricken and struck down by God and afflicted, but he was wounded for our transgressions and crushed, bruised for our iniquities, and upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his stripes we are healed. And people were clueless. People thought he's going to come and be a king, and we're going to be on top now instead of having to be on the bottom. People had it all mixed up. They were clueless. He was going to have to endure taunts and spits and nails and thorns and pope. People didn't understand the significance of this thing, but he rode on.
Right on.
He rode on because he had Ed Harris in mind.
Come on now.
And if I don't keep riding, what happens to Ed? He rode on because he knew a person like me was going to have to know how much he loved me in order for me to respond to his saving grace. So he rode on. He kept riding. He could have slipped in, but he said, no, I'm going to come in and make a public spectacle because I have to make it possible that folk would have a right to the tree of life. So even though folk were clueless, I'm going to ride.
Yes.
And I didn't understand it then, but I sure understand it a little better now. That song that said, ride on, King Jesus.
No man
can hinder thee. There's another part of that song that says, isn't that great? Getting up morning, fare thee well. Fare thee well. In other words, Jesus, keep riding. Go through what you're going through. Ride on. You're going to go through some suffering. It's going to get rough. It's going to be a little tough. But if you can just hold on, because in that great getting up morning, it's going to fare well. So ride on. Oh, that's good. That's good. Remember last week I said every sermon ought to say something great about God. And I just did. I just let you know that this God came in despite the suffering and despite the pain and rode on into Jerusalem knowing that he was going to be killed, knowing that this mission would lead to a cross. He rode on. But I also told you last week, every sermon ought to, in addition to telling you something great about God, it ought to stretch you. It ought to lead you to walk in a different way, right? We. So in addition to rejoicing with understanding on this Palm Sunday and being glad that Jesus rode on, our rejoicing has got to coincide with our actions towards those who, for whatever reason, are being denied their dignity and their human rights on earth, and those who are suffering as a result of our failure to make room for everyone Jesus rode into Jerusalem to set free. So I'm challenging us. So a minute ago when I quoted that song, I said, ride on, King Jesus, no man can hinder thee. But the words to the song actually say, ride on, King Jesus, no man can hinder me. Mm-hmm. And the reason for that is Christ isn't the only one that needs to ride on.
Say it.
There's another hymn that says, must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free?
No.
There's a cross for everyone, and there's a cross for me. And if I'm going to make it to my cross, I've got to ride on. Even when people are clueless about who I am and are clueless about why I do what I do, I've got to ride on. In fact, the Bible encourages us to let the same mind be in us that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard this equality with God as something to be exploited, but he emptied himself, taking on the form of a slave, being born in human likeness and being found in him. He humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. So my brothers and sisters, you need to ride on as well. You need to ride on. Jesus made his triumphal entry on a donkey, a symbol of peace, not war, a symbol of humility, not pride. Instead of coming in like the Romans with a big entourage, riding on a chariot with all of his conquered prisoners behind him, Jesus came riding in on a donkey with a little rough group of common people who he had healed and set free walking behind him. And they don't serve as his trophy case. No, they're his symbol to the world of the magnitude of what he came for. And so for us, it's on us to ride on. We need to ride on. We need to ride on. You see, we ride on and we refuse to be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, knowing that it is the power of God to salvation to everyone who believes. We ride on when we're willing to be transparent with things that we've been through in our lives, that we might be able to share the saving works of Christ with others. We ride on when we allow our needs and our desires to take a back seat to the needs of others. We ride on when we're willing to stand up for the oppressed and those without a voice. We ride on when we realize that injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We ride on when we refuse to let our lights of Christ be diminished by what's going on in the world. Friends may turn their backs on us, but we ride on. We might have to spend some nights with tears rolling down our face, but we ride on. We might lose more than we seem to gain, but we ride on. They may be clueless, but we ride on. They may not understand our mission, but we ride on. They may not understand the magnitude of what we're doing. They may be clueless, but despite their cluelessness, we ride on. My brothers and sisters, be not weary in well-doing, for in due season you shall reap if you ride on. So don't you think about throwing in the towel now because it's getting a little tough. We ride on. So don't you think about, I can't make it this time. You made it every other time. Didn't he bring you through that? He brought you through this. He brought you through that. So ride on. My brothers and sisters, oh my goodness.
Yes, sir.
We, God's people, have a mission and a calling on our lives. And even though the world may be clueless about what we're doing and what we're up to, we have to keep riding. So ride on, my brothers and sisters.
Woo!
Ride on.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
And if there's one in
here
who doesn't know the Lord,
come on now.
I am calling you today to come, repent, and give your life to Christ so that you too can ride on. You see, this thing isn't about us and all the stuff that we can get. We got it twisted. This isn't about me getting my blessings. No. This is about us being, continuing the work of Christ. One last story and we're going to go.
Woo!
Christ left a legacy of ministry, a legacy of love, a legacy that his disciples, us, his people, are duty bound to continue. We are in essence Christ like. And so if we're gonna be Christ like, we need to be like Christ. Think like him. Do like him. Love like him.
Yes.
Won't you come to Christ?
Yes.
Today? Is there one? If so, just type up on the screen, "I surrender." And we will come, and through whatever channels we need to go through, we'll find you on Facebook somewhere, and we'll help lead you to Christ.
Yeah, we'll do it.
Is there one? Is there one? Because aren't you tired of just church as usual? Show up on Sunday just to get my blessing and then go home. Struggle for a week and then come back to church to get my blessing. When there are folk out there that need to know just the blessedness of knowing Christ,
there's the blessing.
Don't you get tired of, all the cliches and all the cute little church-sounding sayings that we hear every time we turn around. I'm rambling now, but I just want, someone needs to know. And maybe there's someone out there, and finally, Lenny, as you make your way back, maybe there's someone who is looking for a church home. And look, it's good to, this pandemic has done some great things. It lets us know, look, a church home is not a building, man.
That's right. Not at all.
Church home, the church is the people who've been called out from the world. We just happen to be one group of folk called out from the world over at Amana. And so maybe you wanna just connect with a group called out if you're not already connected. Right, I'm not trying, we are not trying to get folk who are already connected to come connect over here. Don't get it, that's not the plan at all. We just want folk who want to have a connection, who need a connection, who don't have a connection, to join us at Amana. And if so, just type on the screen, I want to join. And again, we'll track you down, and we will. Anything else there, Lenny?
No. Wonderful.
Right on.
Yeah.
King Jesus, let us pray. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for what you've done in us. And we just pray today that something that you said will resonate in us to the point that when we feel like sitting down, you will remind us, ride on. Mm-hmm. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Do I need to pull this over here, or is the mic on?
You can pull it over there.
Okay, thank you, dear. Now I see why you got a new chair. This thing is jacked up.
Yeah, they used to pick at me when that thing used to just about fall, but oh. Okay, no. Now you see.
All right, look, everybody, thank you again for coming. Especially thank you for those people who invite people to come and share with us. I just want to give a shout out. I think Sean Naylor, she invited people today like it was Easter. I think Sean had a husband, a daddy, a sister. I don't know if Kaylee was on here too. But we just want to welcome everybody, and we want everybody to feel welcome. And Pastor, he said it best. We're not trying to, don't start playing that, because you know I go to, can I hinder me? That's my song. You know I was wanting to sing it while you was preaching, but I knew that wasn't the point. But anyway, you know, we're not trying to go in somebody else's field and their pasture and pluck away their sheep. That ain't how we roll. That ain't how we roll. What we're trying to do is to let people know everybody needs a home. Everybody needs a place to call home. That no matter how far you go, no matter how long you stay away, no matter what you have to do while you're away, you always have a home to come to, and you always have people praying for you and praying with you and lifting you up and supporting you and cheering you on. That's what it means to have a church home. People to hold you accountable, a place where you can work out your soul salvation, a place where your ministry can be nourished so it can flourish. That's what it means to have a church home. And I just want to say this, and then we're going to go. Charmaine Hardison, her name on Facebook is C-Hard, C-E-E-H-A-R-D.
And boy, she going after her sister hard. Her sister is Shelby. I think it's pronounced Devontier. It's a nice little French name. But Shelby's been joining us for a couple of Sundays. And first of all, Shelby, no pressure. We love you, girl. I'm so glad. I am so glad to have you in the building. And wow, it's just it's good to have you close. And I know if it was our desire, we would be closer, but Shelby is like my sister from another mister, and I'm just so glad to have you here. But Charmaine going hard. She's like, you can call this home, Shelby, if you're looking for a church home. So look, we can't go after Shelby no harder than her own sister. So, you know, y'all handle that, and we'll be right here, you know, with open arms. But anyway, so only announcement I have besides, look, prayer call Wednesday morning. Come join us on Wednesday morning. It's our Wednesday morning manna prayer call from 7 a.m. to 7:30 a.m. And then we're saying amen, and we're having the best Wednesday ever. That's how we do. Join us every Wednesday morning at 7 a.m. The number is 760. Do you know it by heart yet? Because my mama ain't on here. My mama had to go to Sunday school at her church, so she can't put it up. But anyway, that's all right. Somebody, Clarissa's got it. Clarissa, now that she's also put up, if you want to plant a seed, a financial seed in Amana. Oh, you know what? I'm glad, Quentin. Quentin, I am so glad that you posted another comment, because I've been wanting to thank you, my brother. Thank you for joining us. You made this a wonderful experience, and we're so glad you had a wonderful experience.
That's my homeboy.
Oh, that's your homeboy?
He knows about them pins.
Oh, you know what? Y'all stupid. You stupid. And I'm going to tell you right now, you better be glad I ain't grow up with you, because I would, oh no, I would have went and got a whole fork and stuck you back. But anyway, okay, Jesus leaving the building again. Okay. Let me get an announcement. So Thursday, we also have our Bible study. So if you want to join us for Bible study, the adult Bible study is right back here on Facebook Live, 6:30 to 7:30 on Thursday, and our kids meet at 5:30. Last but not least, go to our website, amanachurch.org, and go to the pandemic. It's a page that we have on our website. It's pandemic support page. And we have posted a link to FEMA. And the government is now offering to assist and reimburse people who have had to funeralize their family due to COVID. And they're just saying, keep your documents. But we have actually placed the link on our website. If you or a family member or a friend, anybody you know, has had to bury a loved one in these financially bleak times, you know, our government is trying to come through. Hey, you know, so they're offering assistance and reimbursement for people who have died of COVID to help their families be able to lay them to rest. And the link is on amanachurch.org. What just made you jump?
Did Shelby join?
Did Shelby? Ain't no telling. We'll find her. You know we'll find. I can find Shelby. You ain't got. You calm down and take your high blood pressure medicine. You about to get. Go on. Let's finish strong so we can go. No, I think a lot of people just welcoming her. But we'll get her. That's all right. We'll get her. We'll get her, Tiger. All right. Time to finish strong. And Shelby, you might as well go ahead and learn the song, because everybody got you. We in here hugging you like fam now. So come on, Pastor. Hit it. Just follow me. It's a simple song, and it goes a little something like this. Hey. In this race that we run, you gotta have endurance, 'cause it's a marathon. I was born, showed up to win, pursuit with faith. Until the end, I'm going to have a strong finish, 'cause I have strong faith. I'm going to have a strong finish, strong faith. I'm going to have a strong finish, 'cause I have strong faith.
There you go.
Going to have a
strong finish, strong faith.
Life transition, all in my way.
We even got choreography.
But still I'm up and down
each and every day.
No matter what, I
continue to run. And for the rest of my life, until my work is done, I'm going to have a
strong
sing
faith.
It with me. I have
strong faith.
I'm going to have a
strong
faith. Okay, there goes Carlson. Come on, come on.
Strong faith.
I'm going to have a
strong finish.
Cause I have
strong faith.
I'm going to have a
strong finish. Strong
to the chance, say
strong finish, strong finish, strong.
Everybody lift it up, say
strong finish, strong finish,
hey. Strong faith,
strong finish, strong finish, strong. Everybody lift it up, say strong finish, strong finish, strong faith, God promise.
Love y'all.
He